2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 11. And the first thing we talked about last week, and the week before, I think, was adding to your faith. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more this morning. I'm going to try to go quickly here, but I have placed in the bulletin what we're supposed to add to our faith. It's on the left side in the middle. So goodness, knowledge, add to our faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, and love. And I also want to put in there the fruit of the Spirit. We got kind of messed up a little bit with the faithfulness, but that's not your fault, Terry. That's love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. And then underneath that, I have what love is. As you find in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 8. This is what love is. This is what agape is. This is how we're supposed to love. And I talk about that all the time, so I thought I'd throw that out to you, and that you have it in your possession, so you can see this is what love looks like. This is what God's love looks like to me, and this is the kind of love he's asking me to have for those in our church family, those I'm with, my family, my neighbors, the people I'm around. That's the kind of love that he's wanting from me. Love is patient, it's kind, it doesn't end, so forth and so on. Love never gives up. And then the very beginning of chapter 1 of 1 Peter 2, or 2 Peter 2, chapter 1 is, through his divine power, through our knowledge of him, we have all that we need for a life of godliness, or for a godlike life. We have everything that we need. And what is it that we need that we have? In order to live a godly life, these virtues are what we're after, what we want to live. And those are present in our lives. The Holy Spirit is present in our lives, and these are the virtues that God, the Son, the Holy Spirit, possess. That's them. And we have this in our life. So anyway, we're going to talk this morning about adding to our faith. We've already added to our faith. We're going to talk about abounding in faithfulness and fruitfulness. I'm going to go up this morning. And the assurance of forever. So, get where I'm going. So, we're supposed to abound in faithfulness. Let me get my glasses here. So when we're serious about growing as Christians, we will be effective and productive in our lives. That's what 1 Peter says. What Peter says in verses 8 and 9, it says, for if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to the blindness, or even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. And so notice that Peter uses the phrase, these things. He uses those two different times. And what are these things? I've already referred to them. There are seven character qualities listed in verses 5 and 7. Which are again that I've put for you to look at. So we're to abound, Scripture says, in these things, which means to have much or more than enough, to have a surplus of. It reminds me of what Paul said in Philippians 1:9, where he said he longs for our love to abound more and more. When we abound in these, when we abound in fruitfulness, three things are going to happen in our life. First of all, we'll go forward. We'll move forward. We won't be static. We won't be barren, Scripture says. This word means to be slothful or idle. We won't be slothful or idle. Instead, we'll be moving forward. Proverbs 19:15 says this, laziness casts one into a deep sleep. An idle person will suffer hunger. That's what happened to the church of Ephesus in Revelations 2:4. I have that here. I'm going to share it with you. Yeah, it says in Revelation 2:4, it says, yet I hold this against you. This is Jesus talking. You have forsaken the love you had at first. I've heard the rendition, or I've heard the translation, you have forsaken your first love. This says, you have forsaken the love you had first, which I think refers to the enthusiastic emotional commitment to Jesus that they initially had when they became believers in Christ. It's kind of like we all pretty much know when we started dating our spouses and the love relationship we had, the emotional connection that we had was really intense. But then as the years went by, what happened? I'm assuming it's kind of like what happened with me. You know, life becomes tough, and life will bury you, and life isn't easy. And sometimes you tend to, the love intensity that you had for that special person in your life kind of wanes and becomes less. And I've dealt with that. Several years ago, I was going through a situation where I feel like I do not have the kind of love for my wife that I believe I should have. I just don't. I don't like that. So I started praying. I said, God, give me a supernatural love. Okay. Give me a supernatural loving love. Did he answer prayer? It's been pretty amazing. It really has. The change has happened in my life. I'm really grateful for that. Because you know when you're married to somebody that's different than you, you have a problem similar to what they have with you. It's just sometimes it's difficult to put up with us. So Faye has difficulties with me and I have some with her, and we ask God to do something supernatural in our life and give us a love that is this agape, God-like love. Forgiving, loving, patient, kind, accepting, never giving up. So that's the kind of love that the Ephesus church had originally. And he was worrying about that. We don't want to be idle in our relationship or our love. We'll be moving forward. We'll be fruitful as a second. We won't be unfruitful, Scripture says, in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is not just knowing about Jesus, but actually knowing him personally. The word knowledge here refers to becoming thoroughly acquainted with someone. And he puts it this way in John 15:5. He says, he who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. He who knows me and pursues me aggressively and intimately gets to know me. He abides with me. He abides in me. Jesus is already that way. He's there. He loves you unconditionally. And he's pursuing you. Have you ever heard of the scripture that talks about the hound of heaven? Pursuing you. You know, lots of times that refers to people who have not responded to Christ yet. The hound of heaven. Jesus is after them. God is after them. But God's after us. God wants to have a close relationship with us. Lionel Harris, a number of years ago, sang a song. I don't know if I can remember all of it. The song is, I Miss My Time With You. The moments together, talking about Jesus to us. I miss our time. Jesus misses that time when we don't spend time with him, when we don't pursue him to be well acquainted with him and abide in him. And the last one is we'll be focused. When we're spiritually sleepy and stagnant, we can become short-sighted. That's what the scripture says. Able only to focus on what's right in front of us. And that can lead to becoming blind to what really matters. And then we can end up forgetting that we've been set free from the baggage of our old sins. So I don't know if you've dealt with that. You probably have if you're normal like me. There's some times when your spiritual life just is not intense. When you become a little bit neglectful in your pursuit of Jesus, and you experience the separation from him, that's not pleasant. And you can feel that, and it's not an enjoyable experience. And so pursuing him on a regular basis is what's important. And he's, I don't know if I'd say he's fine, but Jesus doesn't have a problem with us messing up. He's there to forgive us and accept us back in, immediately in our life when we turn to him. So we don't want to forget about what's happened to us, because then sin, which is crouching at the door, it says, sin can come after us. Remembering our past sins or being tempted with things today in our life, those can bother us more, cause us to stumble if we're not pursuing him. So we're willing to pursue him. So when these seven characteristics or seven character qualities increase in our life, we will be able to see our salvation more clearly. We'll be able to understand what's going on in our life in terms of our faith. So we need to add to our faith and then to abandon. abound in fruitfulness. And then one more item we need to do is we need to rest in the assurance of forever. Scripture says, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So once again, we are called to be even more diligent, which means to make every effort. Have you ever thought about what it might be to have an entrance into heaven supplied abundantly? That's an interesting thing. What will that be like? What does that mean? Well, this particular portion of Scripture reminds me of Hebrews 6:11, where it says, and we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Us, through faith and patience, we will inherit the promise. That's the persistence. And Peter wants us to make sure that we've really been saved. This is so important that you don't want to hope or guess or wonder. If you're not sure you're saved, you need to settle that right now. I do talk about that often here. My assumptions are that all of you are saved. My assumptions are that people who come here are saved. We know what salvation is, at least the way I preach salvation, it's a personal belief in, trust, and commitment to Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Accepting what he did on the cross for us, the fact that he rose from the dead, and he's waiting in heaven for us, he's going to bring us up to be with him someday. But accepting what he's done for us, that is salvation. So I'm assuming that all of you at some point, in some way, have made the statement, Jesus, I believe I'm a sinner. I believe that I need you to forgive my sins, and I want you to forgive my sins. I want you to live on the throne of my heart and my life, and I want to serve you. I want to live a life that honors you and glorifies you. I surrender myself to you, Father. And like Rob was talking about that statement in the bulletin, I want to be crucified with you. Deny what I think is important and do what you think is important. We all need to come to that point where we do that. And so that's what I'm suggesting and encouraging you to consider. So there are two results of having certainty of your salvation. One is holiness now. Holiness now, the phrase never stumble in the scripture means that you won't lose your footing in your faith and you'll be less prone to stumble into sin. Never stumble. If we keep these virtues forefront in our minds and pursue them, Scripture tells us that we'll never stumble. And then heaven later, we're going to experience that. And the Scripture says, an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So faith saves us, but assurance of that salvation satisfies us, gives us a peace, that hope, that gives us the security that we look for and desire. So the word abundantly was used of an athlete returning home after completing or competing successfully. Have you ever seen these, maybe they're called ticker tape parades, I don't know what they are, but it's when a hero or a successful athlete or a basketball team comes to town, or a football team, maybe that's even bigger, they come to town and there's hundreds of thousands of people recognizing them and just screaming and hollering. Praising what they've done. That's the abundantly we're talking about. So can you imagine yourself stepping into heaven and everybody in heaven just goes crazy? Millions of people just going crazy because you've walked into heaven? You know, that's the kind of thing that's going to happen. We're going to get that kind of reception when we get to heaven. So just lastly, before we sing the song that Karen asked for, I've stated this before, as we've shared this sermon over the three parts, but spiritual growth is intentional. It's not automatic. If we're going to be a Christian, an authentic, biblical Christian on purpose, then we've got to pursue him on purpose. We have to go after the relationship with Jesus Christ. And we have to want to live into the fruit of the Spirit and the virtues that we're talking about here. Here. That's what we want to do. And this is what I do. I have found in my long life that it's hard to do a lot of this stuff that I think I'm supposed to do as a Christian. It's just hard to be, you know, a successful believer. And I have successfully experienced failure more than once in my life. And so far I've learned is to be honest with God. In my quiet time that I do this office, and God, this is what I want to be. This is what I want to do. I know this is what you want me to do. This is how you want me to be. And so I'm asking God to give me the desire, make it the desire in my heart to draw close to you, to live in obedience to you, to be a man who lives out the fruit of the Spirit in my life. Give me that strength. Give me that assurance. Give me that God-directed nudge that I need to be where I need to be spiritually. I just find rather than trying and trying hard, if I just pray and ask God to help me, He'll take care of me, and He will get it done for me. That's what